I was born in Gary, Indiana. I went to Lew Wallace High School there. Gary was a pretty good town when I was a kid. We lived in the southern part of Gary, and our high school was all white at that time. The beach was 4 miles away, Michigan, and we spent a lot of time on the beach. It was, and there were sand dunes to play in, and it was a kind of a fun place. But in recent years, it has changed quite a bit.
Yeah, everything, it seems like. Here's a question for you, so just to get a sense of the kind of kid you were. You know, when you walk into an elementary school classroom, you know, there's the smart kid, there's the shy kid, there's the class clown, there's the, you know, yeah, whatever. If we walked into your elementary school class, which kid were you?
I was a shy kid, by far, I think.
Where did that come from, do you think?
I have no idea. I don't know. My mother died when I was 11 years old, and whether that had an influence on me or not, I don't know. But there are three of us. We had a fourth in the family, but the youngest was adopted by my aunt, and Dad took care of a 13, 11, and a 12-year-old, you know.
Huh. When you think back on your father, what qualities did you admire about him?
Well, he was an immigrant from Greece, and I admire the fact that he went to night school to learn English. He volunteered for World War I, and he got his citizenship as a volunteer going to World War I. His hobby was photography, and he was good at it.
What kind of, if you're able to, because we're going to move on to your experience here, but what kind of influence do you think he had? What qualities or characteristics do you think he passed on to you?
He was kind of shy too. He pretty much didn't interfere in our lives. He just left us alone, you know. And we were pretty good kids, so we never got into major trouble. Yeah.
What year did you go into service?
I was 2 years from 2 months. I'm sorry, 2 months from graduating, and this was the first anniversary of Pearl Harbor. And they announced it in our high school class, in our last semester's class, that if anybody volunteered, they would get their diploma. So the very next day, there were 15 of us that got out of high school to volunteer to go into service.
So you enlisted.
I enlisted.
Tell me about the what it was like. I mean, you're enlisting. What happened after that?
I enlisted. My cousin enlisted with me. We decided to go together, and we were stationed in Port Benjamin Harrison, Indiana. That's where we started out. Gus, my cousin, had odd-sized feet or something. and they couldn't find shoes for him, so they shipped me out of there and left him back there till they got shoes for him. And from there I went to basic training.
When you enlisted, was it exciting?
Was it exciting? Oh, yeah.
Why?
I wanted to go. Yeah.
Why?
Why? Oh.
Because you were going off to war, you know.
I could see a neighbor in uniform, a corporal, and he worked on airplane engines, and I thought, my God, isn't that something? I wish I could be something like that.
Mm-hmm. So, okay, yeah. So. Can you describe, when you enlisted, did you have some sense of where in the service you wanted to go or what kind of job you wanted to do?
Other than Air Force, no, I was kind of mechanically inclined and I was leaning towards mechanics of some kind. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so you enlisted.
I had no idea that I could be a flyer, you know, at that time.
And prior to the time you enlisted, had you ever been in an airplane?
No, I had never been.
Can you sort of take me through your training? Because at some point you ended up in airplanes, and it evidently you didn't see it coming. Can you kind of describe what happened?
I went to basic training in Miami Beach, and we stayed in one of the hotels in Miami Beach, across from Collins Avenue, which was across from the shore. And I remember the tag on a room door that said $43. And I said, my God, hotel rooms at that time were about $6. And here we were in a $43 hotel room. But when my cousin finally caught up with me, he came to Miami Beach. He went to the President Madison, which was on the shore, and his room was about $70. So, but that was not the wartime prices that were being paid by the government to whoever. From basic training, they hauled us in two truckloads. I left my cousin at that time. We didn't know where we were going. It was across Florida. And we were wondering where we were going, you know. We were going through the Everglades and finally wound up at this one place, and a big corporal greeted us, and we all fell out in line. He had us line up in a big long line. There were two truckloads, and that must have been 60 guys. And he had us all in one line, and he drug his toe across the sand. It was sandy in front of us, and said, now this is an aerial gunnery school, and any of you SOBs or chicken shit dada that don't want to fly, step across this line. Well, there was three of us out of 60 that crossed the line, but I was elated. My God, I was going to get to fly, you know. So I had spent 6 weeks in gunnery school and got my sergeant's ratings right after gunnery school. And it was a big time for me. At that time, while in gunnery school, my name was posted on the board that I could apply for pilot's training with several others because of aptitude, I guess. But I was thinking, I was having such a fun time in gunnery school, and it wouldn't be long and I'd see action. I thought, God, if I go through pilot school, the war is going to be over by the time I get there. So I stuck it out. And from there, I went to mechanic school in North Carolina, Seymour Johnson Field.
Why would you go, if you were in gunnery school, why would you go to mechanic school? Or how do those work?
Oh, your aptitude test sent you. Yeah. We went to Salt Lake City, and then we found out we were going to be assigned to a B-17 group.
Did you know, at what point do you find out what position you're going to have on the B-17?
I didn't know the positions on a B-17. I didn't even know what a B-17 looked like until we got to Ephrata, Washington. And there I had my, we were placed on a crew, and I got to meet my crewmates. And
what was the selection process as far as how do you end up with what crew you end up with?
It was, well, that's a long story. Another story. In all the basic training, I had met a kid called Thomas Burns. He was from Boston. And we went through basic together, we went through gunnery school together, and then when I went to mechanic school, he went to radio school. And then on the way to Salt Lake City, when I was being there, on the train, I meet old Tom Burns again. Hey, Tom, hey, he's going to the same place. And we're going to Salt Lake City together. And when we got to Ephrata, well, we happened to meet a corporal when we were out at Soap Lake, they called it. We were waiting to be placed on a crew. This corporal said, well, he works in the office, so if we stop by after 6 o'clock, he'll see if we're on the crew. We stopped by and I was on one crew and he was on another crew, and he just switched names and put us on the same crew. How they do it, I don't know.
But you didn't have a lot of input as far as where you were going to end up.
No.
One question, just going back just a little bit. What was, for people who don't know anything about gunnery school, what was that like?
Oh, it was a fun time for me. Gunnery school, being a hunter, I just loved it. You started out with BB guns, BB machine guns, shooting skeet and trap, and then gradually to your last week you do your aerial stuff. You know.
Most people don't realize how powerful. Were you training on the 50 caliber machine guns eventually?
We only had short firing on a 50 caliber machine gun at gunnery school. I didn't really get to know the 50 caliber until we got assigned to a crew.
Well, let's move ahead then and go back. You've just been assigned to a crew. What was it like, I mean, getting to know these guys? I mean, your lives were dependent on each other.
Yeah. Well, we gradually got to know each other, but the initial thing was when we found out that our pilot was 28 years old, and we said, are we going to fly with that old man? Yeah. That was my initial thought.
Who was your pilot? What was just for the...
His name was Albert M. Bell, B-E-L-L.
Well, what was it, once you were assigned to a crew, what happened after that? What developed after that?
Well, you go through phase training, and that was at Eufrata, Washington.
And what's that? Phase training, what is that?
Initial flying around, dropping practice bombs, then you graduate up to another, we went to Walla Walla, Washington after that for more advanced stuff.
In the beginning, was it kind of uncoordinated as far as getting everybody working together and all that?
Well, I don't think it was. I don't remember that it was.
What was it like initially flying around on that big plane when you first, what was your reaction when you first got on there?
One of the most amazing things to me was we were flying at night, and of course we're out in the desert from Eufrata, Washington, and then we flew to Spokane, Washington, and seeing Spokane at night and all these lights, well, was just like a gem out there, you know. That was quite impressive to me. One incident that happened that is in my memory, and that was a B-17 was flying, it hit a air pocket, and there was a guy in the radio room, and the radio room hatch was open, and he flew out of the hatch without a parachute. And we were we spent 2 days on horseback trying to find his body. We never did. Well, after the phase training, then we were sent to some place in Kansas and got equipped. First, they equipped us with summer clothes, so it looked like we were going to go to the Pacific, and then they switched around and gave us the fleece line stuff, so we're going to England probably. So we ended up in England. We went over on the Queen Elizabeth.
What was it like being on the ship? What did it feel like on the ship?
The ship was crowded. It was 17,000 troops aboard. The Puerto Ricans were also aboard with other nationalities and some Australians and Canadians, but a lot of the foreigners were on the open decks. They were sleeping there, but I was put with my crew, six of us, in the linen closet. We had six bunks in the linen closet, and all our baggage stacked up in the middle. The guy that had the lower bunks couldn't get in his bunk until the baggage was removed. So, yeah.
How do you feed all those people?
We had two meals a day, and how they did it, I don't know. Wasn't very good food.
Did you get out for air at all? You know.
Well, you could. You could, get up in the deck, but it was crowded up there. So,
was there? I'm assuming that was the ship zigzagging and all that stuff, or was?
Yes. We were alone.
So you're not in a convoy?
You're not in a convoy. The Queen Elizabeth was faster than the subs, so. But you sailed a zigzag course so they couldn't get a lock on you. And we made it in 5 days.
What do you do during the day on the ship? I mean, it seemed like it'd get kind of, yeah, get kind of, what did you do to pass the time?
Nothing. No. There were a lot of poker games going on, and I remember that my co-pilot came off with $1,300, and I thought, God, that was quite a...
That's a lot of money back
then. A lot of money.
Was there a, I don't know, kind of an anticipation of what was coming up? I mean, no. Do you remember feeling fear or
no.
excitement or, you know?
No, I was just a kid. I didn't know what fear was yet.
Well, once the, where did the ship land?
Glasgow, Scotland. Mm-hmm. And then we took a train down, and I can remember traveling through Scotland. And when you went by a factory or something, all the gals would be out waving at the troop trains at the Americans going by.
Yeah. Well, do you remember approximately when this was? I never asked how long the training was until, I mean, you're finally in England. Do you remember about when you landed in England?
In early part of November 43. The first time we got off of base and into the little town, it was at night, and all you had was a little pen light, if you had one. My waist gunner and I went into town together, and we had to almost hang on to each other to keep from losing ourselves. And occasionally you'd see a door open, you'd see a little light, and people going in and out, so.
What was the relationship with the locals? I mean, what did the local English people think of with your experience as far as being American?
Well, we didn't really get a feel for the local people until we got to our base and spent some time there. The local people loved us. We had, what was his name? Kendrick was a farmer who owned the land that the base was built on. And he would be farming between the runways. We'd be going off on a mission, you know. But he really loved us.
Was there any commerce of any sort between the soldiers and or between the American, trading goods, you know, with the locals or anything like that?
Not to any great extent that I knew of.
Which position did you end up on the plane?
I ended up as top turret flight engineer. The flight engineer is basically responsible for all the mechanics of the airplane, knowing all the emergency procedures, taking the loading list, making that up.
And a loading list is?
The passenger list. Everybody's serial. I knew everybody's serial number by heart, you know. You pre-flight the airplane. You coordinate with the ground mechanics what the squawks are on the airplane. Make sure everything's ready.
Mm-hmm. And you were a gunner, right? I mean, you had
top turret gunner. Mm-hmm. In combat, you're in a turret. When you're over friendly territory, then you get out of your turret and stand between the two pilots.
During a non-combat period and you're in the plane, did you help the pilot and co-pilot in any way?
You stood between them to aid in observing the function of the airplane. And if there was any problems, you'd go chase them down if you could. Yeah.
Did you like being a flight engineer?
Yeah.
And what was it about that particular job that you liked?
I guess it was having something to do, responsibilities, you know.
Because it sounds like a position where you actually had to have some brains to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, do you know, it was something to do, but what is it about the job that you liked?
Well, I always liked mechanical stuff. I was a natural at it.
How did you know you were going to go out on a mission?
At our squadron headquarters, they had a flag system, and they put up either blue flag, which meant that there was a mission probable, white flag, which all clear, and a red flag, which it's it. There's no turning back now. When the white flag was up, the bars were open, everything is okay. The blue flag, the officers' club and the enlisted men's club closed down a certain time. And you're kind of in standby mode. So that's how we knew or sensed that there was one. And the next thing is somebody waking me up at 2, 3, or 4 o'clock in the morning, get your crew up here. So it was my job to get the rest of the crew up for the enlisted men. The enlisted men, which I was, were separate from the officers. There were four officers to the crew, and they were in a hut right next to us, and we were in a separate hut.
So you get up real early in the morning. Where would you go from there, or what happened?
From there, we go to breakfast. They'd tell us when they woke us up, breakfast is at certain time, and briefing is thereafter. So we'd trudge our way to breakfast and then to the briefing room. And the
were there particular missions that were more dangerous than others? I mean, when you're walking in for the briefing room, what are you thinking when you're walking in there?
Well, what's behind that map on the front?
Because the map's covered up, right?
The map is covered up. When everybody is in, they close the door and they start the briefing. They pull the curtain back, and there you see your route in and route out to your target. And when you see something like Berlin down there, you say, oh my, a lot of oohs, you know.
What would be a type mission that was, I think it was called a milk run?
Milk run.
An easier run.
At the time I was flying my missions, there were what we called rocket installations on the coast. We didn't know what they were, other than the target was right there and you go hit it, you know. Those were milk runs. In fact, I had one run. It was real short. We opened our bomb bay doors almost over England yet, and over the, we released the bombs, before we hit the coast of France, or Belgium it was, as you know, the bombs carry forward with the, so we made our turn before we even,
you barely
just
hit
landfall,
Yeah.
That was my last mission, and that was a milk run.
So we go back to the briefing room. Cover comes off the map. You see what kind of run your mission it's going to be. Where does it go from there? I mean, as far as what happens, I mean, at some point you get out to the plane.
Well, right after the briefing, they take you by truck to your plane. And you take out your guns from the tent that you put them in, and you wipe them down again, and you install them in the airplane. And as a flight engineer, I had to take the mechanics reports, go over them with them, and make out the loading list.
Tell us about what it's like to take off on a fully laden B-17.
Well, let me tell you about the guns first. One of the reasons we take the guns out of the airplane is that you have to wipe them down and get that English moisture wiped off of them, because your guns will freeze up on you if they're not cleaned and not too much oil put on. They'll freeze up on you and won't fire. So you got to take care of your guns, and we kept them in our engineer's tent alongside a little fire that he had going all the time. When you're fully loaded, well, you're kind of sweating the takeoff, hoping that all engines purr as you're going down the runway. And most of the time we'd have a group of 21 airplanes, three squadrons of seven airplanes each. And that essentially came from one airfield, which was, ours was Framlingham, Square J. We also flew with the 100th group, which came from a different airfield, and the 95th group. The three of us, our groups made up a wing, a 13th combat wing. And one of our groups would be the lead of the three, and we kind of took turns at that. Then there would be umpteen combat wings, and I don't know how many combat wings there were exactly. Yeah. So it could be 1,000 airplanes. One big long line. And the timing has to be perfect, and everybody taking off, meshing and getting it all arranged. And you notice on our airplane out here, you see a big letter on the tail, like ours is a Square J, 390th Bomb Group Square J. One of the reasons for having such a big letter on the tail is so you could identify each other. When you're taken off in darkness or in very bad weather in England and breaking through the clouds and get above the clouds, then you start looking for, where is my buddy that I'm supposed to follow, So, because there are 40-some fields of 8th Air Force heavy bombers all taking off at the same time, and England is not a very big country, And we're all located in East Anglia, which is just a section. So traffic controllers would have a nightmare. We had fighter protection, but at first they couldn't go all the way with us. We only had Spitfires, English, that took us across the channel, and then P-47s that would pick us up across France. But they couldn't go the whole distance until the P-51 came out in January of 44. And then things start to improve considerably. Then we had, but timing was always a problem because the fighters couldn't, had the range, but they didn't have the duration that the bombers had. So they'd have to take turns, one group after another, protecting us. So you still had German fighter attacks. Well, it was my second mission, actually. The first one, I didn't see any enemy fighters. Second one, we went to Emden, and as we turned towards the target, next thing I knew, I looked up and I saw a fleeting airplane going by with his guns blazing, and all of a sudden my knees got a little weak. I said, "He's shooting at me," you know. But he shot our lead airplane down. That's when we lost Major Hansel at that mission.
How do you shoot at a target that's moving that fast?
You know what? I didn't even get a shot at them. He moved so fast, I didn't see him till he was on me, and by the time I could swing my guns around, he was gone from a head-on attack.
Were there missions where you were able to shoot at fighters?
Oh, yes, yeah.
Was there a strategy or a tactic in lining up to shoot at a fighter?
No, because their tactic varied from every time I had an occasion to fire. It was something different.
Do you know if you ever hit a fighter?
I was credited with damaging a 109 and destroying a ME-110.
Did you knew it at the time that you'd hit them? Can you describe
Yes.
describe what happened on those occasions?
Well, the ME-109, we had one of our airplanes in our formation had dropped out, and we were behind, and we decided to replace him, and we swung out of the formation to go around at the same time on ME-109 as we were flying alongside. Apparently saw us go out, so he dove in on us, and I happened to see him coming from straight above. And I didn't know I hit him, but my crewmates, since I was top turret, I couldn't see a down, you know. They say pieces were falling off of him, so I was credited with a damage. On the Messerschmitt 110, it was a very odd attack. It looked like a group of B-17s were turning back, and I was in my turret, of course, and I reported to the co-pilot on the intercom, hey, there's a group of B-17s turning back and at 2 o'clock position. When they got alongside of us, you could tell they weren't flying fortresses. They were ME-110s with rockets slung under each wing that looked like a B-17.
These were German planes.
These were German planes, and they swung behind us and lobbed their rockets in on us. And they knocked down our wingman and the one guy behind us, and we got caught in a lot of the concussions, I guess, and got caught in a prop wash, and then we went sailing back, and we were right in the middle of them. And they were first time I'd seen anything so slow, and so they just floated right by us. So I got one, and as I went to pick up the next one, my turret went out and it wouldn't swing to the left, so I had to make a 360 degree turn to pick up the next one. By that time, then they were all gone, but I could have gotten more. Mm-hmm. Our group got credit for 22 of them that day.
Did you know you were hitting that plane when you were shooting at it? I mean, can you see pieces flying off it, or how do you know?
Oh yeah, it blew. It went. Yeah, that one went.
What was the feeling you had about the Germans at that point? I mean, you know, do you hate them? They're the enemy. Is it all strictly business? Is it professional? I mean, what is it? What do you?
You know, you're shooting at a machine. The human aspect doesn't come into play like it might on ground forces, yeah. Until you get to meet some of these guys. Flak, all you see is black smoke. But when you're really close to them, you can see the red fire on the inside when it goes. And it can be damaging to you even after it's expended, because you're flying into the fragments that are falling. So it has terrific explosive power if you get a direct hit, but you can get damages from just flying into fragments, you know.
Is there any way to protect yourself?
To protect yourself, we had what's called flak suits, but I never took one in top turret with me. The waist gunners and tail gunners and even the navigator and bombardier would wear a suit that had flak protection to it.
Well, why didn't you ever wear one going into the turret?
Well, I tried wearing a helmet one time, and the flak suit was just uncomfortable in turret. The helmet, metal helmet, when I raised my guns up at one time when a fighter was up above me, the sight pushed the helmet over my eyes, and I said, heck with this. Take my chances without it.
How cold was it on these missions?
Well, I was flying in wintertime, and on one mission, our navigator froze his feet after 16 combat missions, on his 16th, and he couldn't fly anymore. But he claims that his thermometer was pegged at 70 below zero. What? And he's got a thermometer up there in the nose with him.
What protection for the cold were you given? I mean,
it varied on your position. Up in the cockpit area, you had some heat up there, cabin heat. Top turret was probably one of the warmest spots because you're always flying above the clouds. The sun is beating down on you. Heat rises and you're in the highest position. But those guys in the nose, and then especially in the open waist at the time I was flying, we didn't have windows at the waist guns on the side guns. They're just opening. And of course they had to wear their normal uniforms, then they'd put electric heated suits, and the electric heated suits had booties with them and gloves that you connected to the suit, and the suit itself was connected to the power supply, which was a rheostat too that controlled the amount of heat that you could put into the suit. And over the top of that, then they had all their fleece line gear. And over their head, they had the fleece line helmets, the goggles, the oxygen mask. And then the waist gunners would wrap scarves around the whole mess to keep their. So it was not a very comfortable situation. But I guess you didn't think about it too much. We thought about other things.
When you were flying, was it you were done at 25 missions at that point?
At the time I started, it was 25 missions. I had 22 missions in when they upped it to 30. So they prorated one more mission on me. I had to fly 26. Some of my crew had to fly more because they were grounded for a couple missions or so.
What was the countdown like, those last missions? I mean, you've made it, this far.
Well, the countdown for me was entirely different than most people. I had volunteered for my first mission on another crew, so I was ahead of the crew on missions.
That's an interesting question. Why did you volunteer to start early like that?
Well, we were not operational yet because our heavy flying equipment hadn't arrived at the base. It got lost in shipment. And we were waiting for that before we could make our first mission. But this one morning, squadron officer wakes me up and says, "Hey, we need a volunteer on," it was on a crew. Happened to be a Phil Dower's crew, which I got to know later. But when I said, "Well, hell, I don't have my fleece line gear," and he said, "Don't worry, we'll get you something." Well, I was kind of eager to go, but and this was an occasion, I guess. So go out to the, they take me out to the airplane. It's already, they already had breakfast, they already had been briefed, they were at their airplane. And here I'm, they just waken me up and they drug me out there and they find a jacket here and a notching mask there and something else there, and I'm wearing everybody else's equipment. They couldn't find a pair of fleece-lined boots, so they did find a pair of goulashes and they gave me those goulashes. Then I get to the airplane and the pilots briefed me on where we're going, and he says, oh, I don't need an engineer, I need a tail gunner. Well, hell, I'm not a tail gunner. But the ground armament man had already put the guns in the airplane and tail, and I said, well, hell, I'll go.
You went as a tail gunner?
I went as a tail gunner on my first mission. The target is a aircraft engine plant right outside of Paris. And we take off, and as we're climbing out, it came to the time to put on your oxygen mask. I tried to put on my oxygen mask. And a strap was broke on the one side, so I had to hold the oxygen mask with one hand. And I couldn't get didn't know how to adjust the seat back there. In fact, I'd never been in the tail. Of all the time I was in the B-17 up to that time, I'd never been in the tail. And so I'm crouched down, and it starts to get, my feet starts to get cold because I turn up the heat. My feet are still getting cold, turn up, and then it's, I'm starting to burn on between my feet because of the folded up electric heated suit. It's concentrated there. So I was most fortunate that we only went to 16,000 feet that day on that mission, because normally we'd be up at 22, 24,000 feet on a normal mission. But this was a lower altitude mission. I don't know what would have happened to me, but that cured me of volunteering, that's for sure. Besides, my pilot chewed me out too for volunteering to go with another crew.
Was a mission what you thought it was going to be?
Yeah, pretty much so. We didn't have any major threats on that particular mission. So fighting the environment was my biggest concern at that time, and hanging on to the machine gun with one hand, my oxygen mask with the other hand, and being in a crouched position, that was, came back, made up some stories to tell my crewmates.
It must have, your feeling about going out on missions, it must have evolved over time with more and more experience. Did it get to a point when your later missions that it was strictly business? What did it feel like as more of an experienced crew member? You've just described being a neophyte in the beginning. Yeah. What did it feel like near the end as far as being an experienced?
Well, near the end, you're kind of sweating out each one, and I'm getting near the end. I might make it. You know, the 35 crews started the same time my crew started. We went over with 35 crews, signed to the 390th. And only 12 crews finished out of the 35. So you see all your buddies going down. Like in our Quonset hut, we had Bowman's crew that was shot down after about seven missions. And we had Dover's crew come in, and they were shot down, and we're still there. We finally made it.
How do you handle it mentally? How do you deal with that kind of adversity?
I guess each individual is different. I could see it on my radio operator and one of the waist gunners that they were having a very difficult time. My tail gunner was but we made it.
Why were you able to handle it, though? What was it?
I don't know. I was young and stupid.
But you had to be there had to be a tough aspect, though, to you.
Well, let me, on my last mission, I was thinking I was going to, before the mission, I was thinking I was going to volunteer for one mission so I could finish up with the makeup for the fact that I had flown that first. And the pilot, I would be with him, and a co-pilot, they both had made all of their missions. Some of the crews missed a few, but on the last mission, I said it was a milk run. It was the one that was, we opened the bomb bays almost over England. But on takeoff, on that particular mission, scared the heck out of me. We were lining up when the mission started on the taxi strip. You all in line, B-17 after B-17, we fell in line. And as we were taxiing along, then suddenly we were off the run the taxi strip into the mud. So we had to gun the airplane with full power to make a loop to get back on the taxi strip. It was a terrific wind blowing sideways. It had rained all night, and the pilot was mentioning, well, something wrong with this brake, he thought. But then things seemed okay, and it came our turn for takeoff, and as we're going down the runway, getting near liftoff speed, he veers off the runway again into the mud. Into the wind. The airplane has a normal tendency to turn into the wind, you know. And we're going across the mud, and we're pushing full force on the superchargers in emergency power. And the engineer's tent comes up, and we pull off, and the airplane flops down on the other side, again in the mud, and then the trees are coming up. We finally stagger off near stall, just in staggering position. And finally gets enough speed, we level out, and we make our mission, and we're kind of anxious when the gear goes down to see if that wheels are turning, that there isn't any brake dragging or something. Everything's okay. We land okay. Everything seems fine. And we go to interrogation. Interrogation is after a mission, you all sit around and your interrogating officer asks you all those questions. You know. And I'm sitting across from the pilot in this, like a banquet table, you know. And our squadron CO comes up behind my pilot and puts his hands on his shoulder. He's right across from me, and he says, "Bell, what the hell happened to you back there?" And me, I said, "Oh, he's a great pilot. He got us going." He said, "He did a good job." He said, "Like hell he did." He said, "I was two airplanes back, and I didn't see that rudder move one goddamn bit." I said, "Oh my God, my pilot's getting tired." So you know what? I chickened out. I didn't volunteer for that extra mission. Mm. Yeah, well, he was okay on that next mission, last mission.
So he survived the war?
He survived the war. In fact, of all my crew survived the war. But today there's only two of us left, you know.
Were there crew members through the missions that were injured during the course?
Yes, my missions? Navigator was with the frozen feet. He only made the others all finished their missions, but took them longer. Hmm. And I was gone by that time. I think we had two or three Purple Hearts. The Bolter gunner passed out at one time from lack of oxygen. His oxygen mask froze up, and we had to emergency him out of the ball, hand crank him out, and drug him into the radio room, gave him 100% oxygen, and he spent a couple of days in the hospital afterwards. But there weren't any shell hits, wounds, you know. Yeah.
Were there rituals for luck that people did? You know what I mean? They carried the rabbit's foot. They wore the same clothing. They did. Was there anything like that, or did you have anything like that?
Not that I noticed on my crew. No.
How close did everybody get?
We're all pretty close, except the tail gunner. He was kind of odd. He kept to himself.
Did you tend to get close with other crews?
No.
Was there a reason, or?
Well, there was no specific reason other than you're so I don't know. Maybe you didn't want to. You know, you were always tired from missions. You look forward to a 3-day pass to London, and then, only one, no two crews could arrange the same time, I don't think, you never had the occasion to socialize a hell of a lot with other people, you know. And nor did you want to.
Why not?
You wanted to get the missions over with and go on home. Yeah.
Once you'd done your missions and you were done, and what was the relief like? I mean, what happened that night or that?
Well, since I finished up before the rest of the crew, some of my crew was still flying. I got orders by myself to go down to Cheddington And there I found out I was being assigned to 802nd Recon Group, where normally people were being sent home after they finished. At the 802nd Recon Group was under the command of Elliot Roosevelt, the president's son. And
what would you be doing there? Or what?
They said at first that we'd be flying courier missions between North Africa, England, and Iceland. That kind of fell through. We only had skeleton crews. We only had the two pilots, the engineer, and the navigator observer. So it was only a four-man crew, five-man crew with the, five-man crew, I guess. That kind of fell through, and then we were started flying weather missions. On this field, there were B-17s and B-24s. The B-17s, like myself, were all veterans from various groups. And the B-24s were all non-veterans, combat veterans.
Was this still in England?
In England, in Watton, England. We wound up down there at Watton, England, which is below London. The B-24s were assigned heavy weather. They'd go out there for a long time. The B-17s called light weather, and we only went off for a short while. Well, on one particular mission that the B-24s were on, there was only one B-24. He was on a weather mission, and a Ju-88 night fighter picked him up at night over the ocean and shot him up pretty bad. And they figured the only way the Ju-88 could find him out there in the ocean was that he must have homed in on his radio signal, which was an identification signal that you sent out, IFF, friend or foe. A few days later, we were scheduled to make a weather mission, light weather, and we were told, don't turn your IFF on. Normal procedure was that you always had it on to identify you when you're flying. That we would have ground clearance. This was at night, and also I was assigned identification flares. We took off and headed directly west till we hit water. And in the meantime, the searchlights had tracked us, and we got close to the west shore, and about three searchlights hit us at the same time and decided to go ahead and shoot a flare because it looked like they were getting kind of anxious. So we shot one flare and they turned them off, and we went over the ocean and came down. This was before D-Day, and all the troops were massed in southern England, getting ready for the invasion. And as we were coming back north over Beachy Head area, I happened to crawl in the top turret at that time, no guns in it. And I could see some gun flashes on the ground, and I call up the co-pilot, said, hey, they're shooting at something back there. About 5 miles back, there was a burst, so I could see him. But I was just in the sentence when the searchlights hit us right away. Normally, they'd got to find you first, but they hit us right away, and we were only at 12,000 feet. And they start shooting at us. The co-pilot turns on the IFF, the pilot goes into evasive action, I'm firing flares, and they turn them all off, but by that time we lost the two engines on the right side, and the pilot calls up for an emergency landing and field, and they lit up a English base that we landed in and ground looped. So
the irony of surviving all those missions.
Of the combat missions, and
they're going to shoot you down on a friendly weather mission.
Yeah. Well, it wasn't long after that that they sent me back, and they gave me a choice of several fields to go to, and I chose one closest to home, which was Cortland, Alabama, and it turned out it was a B-24 base, and so I got on a test hop crew there, and I spent some time with B-24s, so I got to know both airplanes, and you know, they're kind of rivals. From there, it wasn't long before the war was winding down, and I got out on my 85 points. They had an 85 point system, and I had qualified for getting out quick. So I did. Well, after the war, I took advantage of the GI Bill. We were on, going back, we were on a troop train getting ready to be discharged, and we're talking amongst each other, what the hell are we going to do, you know? And someone says, well, you're mechanically inclined. He said, why don't you get your A&E license? And the more I thought about it, the more maybe that's what I ought to do. I wrote to Parks Air College and wanted to sign up for A&E license, and they said, oh, we don't have that, just A&E. We've got certificate courses in operations engineering and maintenance engineering, but we got a degree course in aeronautical engineering, and I said, well, hell, I might as well go the full bore and go aeronautical engineering and get my A&E license too. And so I went to Parks College and I got my aeronautical engineering degree, private pilot's license, A&E mechanics license, and A&E instructor's licenses.
Didn't know when to stop.
And then I started working for McDonnell Aircraft Company in St. Louis not as an engineer, but as a cost estimator, because they wanted to try engineers out in the pricing business. And I got to contract pricing of changes to airplanes and the Banshee airplane production contracts, and I became this country's first manned space contract pricing with the Mercury program. You remember that? I had the whole contract pricing department I was manager of the department when I retired.
Here's sort of my last question is, you know, at the age you are now and with the life experience that you've got now, when you look back at yourself in those war years, I mean, what's your feeling about it? What do you think about when you look back all those years with what you know now and when you look back, what's your feeling about it?
How could I have been?
How could you have been? What do you mean?
How'd I have all the nerve to do all this? You know?